Imagine one day, you receive a subpoena saying that you are suspected to be a member of the Communist Party. You come to this court hearing and are told by the judge that you must prove without doubt that you are not a communist, or you could lose your job or even be sentenced to prison. Well, that's what it was like for many of the victims of Senator Joseph McCarthy. Because he made many communist accusations, McCarthy created conflict by refusing to compromise. This proved that even though his accusations were false, the American people still believed him because of their fear of communism.
It's time for the Longines Chronoscope. Our distinguished guest for this evening is the Honorable Joseph R. McCarthy, United States Senator from Wisconsin.
My purpose, Mr. Huey, will be about the same as the purpose in some 12, 13 states I'll visit, and that is to bring important facts to the American people.
What is the broader interpretation of your own victory in Wisconsin as you see it?
Well, I would say, Mr. Haslett, number one, it was not a vote for McCarthy. It was a vote on an issue, an all-important issue. The American people recognized that the one real issue, not the phony issue, is the issue of communism, corruption, all tied up with the Korean War.
To give some historical context, 20 years before McCarthy's rise to power, the Great Depression hit America, which caused exponential growth for communism because of the fail of capitalism. As the years progressed, Americans started to see the dangers of communism, from the terrible purges carried out by Joseph Stalin to the Soviet Union helping Nazi Germany invade Poland. Communism seemed to be the last thing the U.S. wanted. Because of this, in 1938, the House of Representatives forms the House Un-American Activities Committee, also known as HUAC. And in 1940, the Smith Act was passed, which made promoting overthrow of government using violence illegal. One of the first examples of true fear of communism in America was the Hollywood Ten. The Hollywood Ten were a group of people involved in making Hollywood movies that refused to answer HUAC's questions about communist affiliation, and because of that, received fines and prison sentences. But things only got worse in 1949 when the Soviet Union had succeeded in testing their first atomic bomb, and the Chinese Communist Party had taken control of China, which caused America to grow a strong fear of communism. Shortly after, in 1950, State Department official Alger Hiss is brought up on charges of lying about communist ties in his past. This causes both Republicans and Democrats to strive to be extremely anti-communistic. But just as America's fear of communism grows, one Wisconsin senator sees an opportunity to manipulate people in order to gain power. On February 9, 1950, Senator Joseph McCarthy gives a speech at the Ohio County Women's Republican Club in Wheeling, West Virginia, claiming that he has a list of 205 Communist Party members that are in the State Department working and shaping policy. Despite the fact that McCarthy didn't have any evidence for his claims, his speech boosted him into the public eye and turned him from just a senator from a small town into somewhat of a public figure. After the speech, the Tidings Committee was created, which the majority Democratic Senate wanted to use to damage McCarthy's reputation and stop the issues with communist infiltration. In fact, chairman of the committee, Millard Tidings, was quoted on saying, "Let me have McCarthy for 3 days and he'll never show his face in the Senate again." But luckily for McCarthy, many conservative, anti-communist journalists helped him get his information. During the hearings, McCarthy named 9 people who he claimed to be communists, but it turned out all 9 were not. One person McCarthy named during the hearings was State Department consultant Owen Latimore, but McCarthy later removed his charges on Latimore after he made a very unconvincing argument about him being the top Russian agent in the country, and Latimore ended up coining the term McCarthyism, meaning to make accusations without any evidence. After the Tidings Committee hearings were finished, the committee reported on McCarthy saying his accusations were false and charged him for making fraudulent claims. Even though McCarthy wasn't successful in convincing the Senate of his communist charges, he did have a powerful ally in the FBI. FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover was having weekly meetings with McCarthy about communist infiltration in the government, and McCarthy was also gaining popularity from the press coverage. After McCarthy's failures in the Tidings Committee hearings, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg are indicted and later convicted of espionage, which they get sentenced to death for. The Rosenberg case had a lot of controversy surrounding it, since at the time, Julius and Ethel had 2 young children that would lose their parents, so a campaign was created that attempted to save the Rosenbergs, but was not successful. After the Rosenbergs were indicted, McCarthy is sued by muckraking journalist Drew Pearson after McCarthy drunkenly kneed Pearson in the groin and slapped him across the face. The fight only furthered the fact that McCarthy was an alcoholic that couldn't control his temper. But one of McCarthy's worst effects on somebody was on Robert La Follette Jr., the candidate that McCarthy beat in the 1947 Wisconsin senatorial election. In 1953, McCarthy was at the height of his power, and La Follette was fearing being called to testify before McCarthy. Because of this, on February 24, 1953, Robert La Follette Jr. ended his life using a gun his father gave him as a child. Then, in 1954, with no one left to target in the government, McCarthy focused his attention on the U.S. Army. McCarthy brought up charges of communist infiltration on the Army Signal Corps at Fort Monmouth. Following McCarthy's accusations toward the Army, Edward R. Murrow, a broadcast journalist who opposed McCarthy, talks about the undeserving discharge of Air Force Lieutenant Milo Radulovich on his show See It Now. Murrow discusses the effects of McCarthy's reckless accusations, which causes the Army to reinstate Radulovich.
No one familiar with the history of his country can deny that congressional committees are useful. It is necessary to investigate before legislating. But the line between investigating and persecuting is a very fine one, and the junior senator from Wisconsin has stepped over it repeatedly. His primary achievement has been in confusing the public mind as between the internal and the external threats of communism. We must not confuse dissent with disloyalty. We must remember always that accusation is not proof, and that conviction depends upon evidence and due process of law. We will not walk in fear one of another. We will not be driven by fear into an age of unreason if we dig deep in our history and our doctrine.
Another reporter, Murray Martyr, calls out McCarthy's accusations, saying that with the information available about the Fort Monmouth case, there is not enough evidence to make the accusations McCarthy made.
So they had set up this an investigation supposedly at Fort Monmouth, so I got there and got a hold of the lawyers and so forth, and found out there were 33 cases. Well, Joe had been talking this up. You know, he looks like he's going to crack the world's greatest spy ring and so on. So I did my investigation, went to see these people, and the charges were even flimsier than most reading the Daily Worker. Or I knew somebody who had gone to school with somebody else who was thought to be a communist. It was really the dregs of the Loyalty Security Board hearing.
Because of McCarthy's accusations against the Army, he started the 36-day-long Army McCarthy hearings, which is where McCarthy started to lose most of his power. With the memory of World War II still in the minds of most Americans, they didn't tend to believe McCarthy's charges against the Army. During the hearings, Army counselor Joseph N. Welch called out McCarthy for having no sense of decency, after McCarthy accused a lawyer on Welch's firm for having worked for a communist group.
May I say that Mr. Welch talks about this being cruel and reckless. He was just baiting. He has been baiting Mr. Cohen here for hours, requesting that Mr. Cohen, before sundown, get out of any department of the government anyone who is serving the communist cause. Now, I just give this man's record, and I want to say, Mr. Welch, that it has been labeled long before he became a member, as early as 1944.
Senator, may we not drop this? We know he belongs to the Lawyers Guild. And Mr. Cohen nods his head at me. I did you, I think, no personal injury, Mr. Cohen.
No, sir.
I meant to do you no personal injury. And if I did, I beg your pardon. Let us not assassinate this lad further. Senator, you've done enough. Have you no sense of decency, sir? At long last, have you left no sense of decency?
After the hearings, McCarthy was censured by the Senate for making false accusations during the hearings, and it was found that McCarthy's subcommittee never found a single instance of espionage or subversion. After this, McCarthy's power lessened, and in 1957, McCarthy died of alcohol-related cirrhosis at age 48. McCarthy and his accusations show what can happen in the system of guilty until proven innocent, how it can put innocent people in jail and damage their reputation. It is important that we look for evidence before we believe things, otherwise we could end up in the same situation as the US and McCarthy.